This is Dr. Yasir Ishaq from Oral Maxillofacial Surgery. How are you? I hope everybody is doing great. I hope all of you are following proper instructions, and I hope all of you are taking proper precautions to prevent this pandemic coronavirus. And I hope all of you are safe, healthy. So coming to the topic, we were discussing about the local anesthesia, about its types, about its indications, contraindications, contents, etc., etc. Our today's topic is topical anesthesia. So what is topical anesthesia? As its name describes itself, it's a topical anesthesia, means you don't have to inject the local anesthesia. You just apply this local anesthetic agent topically over the skin, over the mucosa, wherever local anesthesia is to be given. Local anesthesia, topical anesthesia can be given either as a sole treatment or before doing any minor surgical procedures. Like for example, if you want to extract a mobile tooth and the patient is anxious and the tooth is mobile, then you can use topical anesthesia, or you can use topical anesthesia before giving injections or before doing a prick in the mucosa or skin. Topical anesthesias basically are used, should be used in every case, but it is basically they are used in anxious patients. For example, if the patient is a young female and she is not letting you allow to give inferior alveolar nerve block or infiltration because of the fear of pain. So how you can reduce her pain is you can apply a topical anesthetic agent over the area where you have to inject, where you have to give local anesthesia. So topical anesthesias basically are given before giving the actual injections, before pricking the mucosa or skin. Similarly, topical anesthesias, what they actually do is, our main purpose is to reduce the pain of needle, the pain of prick from the local anesthesia. So what they actually do is, in our previous lectures we have studied about the field blocks, about the nerve blocks, about the infiltrations. So actually what topical anesthesia is doing, it is anesthetizing the peripheral nerve endings of the area to be anesthetized. Once peripheral nerve endings has been anesthetized, then when you will prick the mucosa, it will be less painful, it will be less uncomfortable for the patient. Topical anesthesias are effective in very limited cases or in very limited types of procedures where there are chances of minimal pain, or there are superficial procedures. For example, you are not going inside, you are not clean an abrasion. Patient is having road traffic accident and you have to clean the abrasion area, you can use topical anesthesia because it's a superficial procedure you have to perform. It's not effective in case of deep surgical procedures. The total depth of penetration for topical anesthesia is usually 2 to 3 millimeter. So it's mean they are, as a sole treatment option, as a sole anesthetic option, they are only effective once you are doing only superficial procedures. Once you have to do deep surgical procedures, you have to perform, for example, extraction of a sound tooth, or you have to do suturing, or you have to do any surgical procedures by placing deep incisions, they are only of help before giving local anesthesia, before doing prick, so that the pain of the prick can be minimized. Topical anesthetic agents, they are available in different forms. For example, they are available in the form of gels, they are available in the form of paste, they are available in the form of ointment, and they are available in the form of sprays. So basically these are different variations, they are different types of preparations available as per your requirement or as per your preference or as per your choice. Most commonly we use gels or sprays. There are different local anesthetic agents which are available for topical preparations. The key is in the topical preparations, because you are not injecting it, you are just applying it topically, they are in concentrated concentrations. For example, once we have studied about the lidocaine, we were using it in the concentration of 2%, but in the case of topical anesthetic agents, we are using it up to 15%, even up to 20% preparations are available, because it's a superficial application, topical application. So you have to be very careful. You have to be very careful when you are applying topical preparations in higher concentrations. So most commonly we use benzocaines and lidocaine. Benzocaine, as we have discussed in the classification of local anesthetic agents, I hope you guys remember, benzocaine is a ester type local anesthetic agent, and lidocaine is from the amide group. So from the ester type, benzocaine is available, and it's usually used in 20% concentration. Lidocaine is our favorite. It can be used up to 5% cases in the form of ointments, or in the form of sprays up to 10 or 15% concentrations. The main problem with the benzocaine is, as we have discussed regarding the ester group, allergic reactions are more common in ester groups. So with the benzocaine, there are reported cases of allergic reactions to the topical anesthetic agent. Although systemic allergic reactions are very rare in the case of any topical anesthetic agents, but in the case of local allergic reactions, these are common with benzocaines. While lidocaine is more safer, and it is also easily available, it is also more effective in the case of topical anesthetic agents. Usually gels are preferred over the sprays in case of topical anesthetic agents used in our region in oral maxillofacial surgery or in dentistry, because in the case of gel, there is more controlled application. You can apply it exactly at the area where you want to anesthetize. In case of spray, if once you are using spray, you can anesthetize even the unwanted area. For example, if you are anesthetizing the inferior alveolar nerve block area and you are using spray, you can anesthetize the pharyngeal tissues as well. So it will be uncomfortable for the patient for next 1 hour with this anesthetized state. So secondly, there are more widespread. The application of gel sprays is more widespread, more area is anesthetized. Number three, the problems with both topical anesthetic, it can be regarding the taste. Everybody, especially if a patient who is already anxious, he cannot, if he is not liking the taste, again, the level of anxiety will be more, he will be more uncooperative. Second drawback for the topical anesthetic is, for example, if you are applying topical anesthesia and then you are planning to apply for prick or infiltration or a block, it's mean you are taking more time. Once initially for the application of topical anesthesia, then for the application of infiltration. It means the if the patient is already in anxious state or he or she is having opened his mouth for prolonged time, it means you are taking more time and he is again in more anxious state for a prolonged time. So it should be used carefully. It should be used only in the desired conditions. The second topic is vasoconstrictors used in the local anesthesia. Let's conclude the topical anesthetic agents. Topical anesthetic agents are basically the agents which are applied topically over the mucosa or skin before actually applying the, before pricking the skin or mucosa, before infiltrating or before giving the inferior alveolar or any block. They are available in the form of gels, sprays, ointments, and most commonly used are benzocaines. They are used in 20% of concentrations, and lidocaines, they are used in 5% to 10% in the case of ointments or gels, and up to 15% in the case of sprays. And indications are before giving the inferior alveolar nerve block, before giving the infiltrations inside the oral cavity, and as a sole anesthetic plan in the case of minor surgical procedures, as I told you, like for the cleaning of abrasions, for the superficial debridements, or for the extraction of mobile tooth, etc. Now, next topic is vasoconstrictors used in local anesthesia. When we have studied about the contents of local anesthesia, we were discussing that it contains vasoconstrictors. Vasoconstrictor used commonly is, we have already discussed, it's epinephrine. And what are the basically indications for vasoconstrictor? Why vasoconstrictors are used in local anesthesia? So basically, they are having four functions or four indications in the local anesthetic agent. Number one is they increase the depth of anesthesia, they increases the duration of anesthesia, they reduces systemic toxicity, and they do hemostasis. How? Vasoconstrictors are basically, let's go to the next slide, then we'll be coming back. Basically, vasoconstrictor actually do is, it stimulates beta 1 receptors in the heart and they increase the heart rate, they increases the strength of contraction and myocardial oxygen consumption. At the same time, they stimulate beta 2 receptors, which causes vasodilation in the blood vessels. So now, coming back to the first slide, how they actually performing these four functions: increases the depth of anesthesia or duration of anesthesia, or reducing the systemic toxicity. So actually, when we are injecting local anesthesia somewhere in the oral cavity, which contains epinephrine, what happens is it causes localized vasoconstriction. So when vasoconstriction occurs, it means the local anesthetic agent is not going to systemic circulation. It has been restricted to specifically to that area where local anesthesia has been applied, because vasoconstriction due to epinephrine is not letting the local anesthesia to go into the vessels and hence into the systemic circulation. It means the more period of time, local anesthetic will be deposited to the that particular area. It means it will increase the duration of local anesthesia. Then again, it reduces systemic toxicity. Again, it's self-explanatory. When there is a vasoconstriction, the local anesthesia, although ultimately it have to go into the systemic circulation, but due to vasoconstriction, due to epinephrine, its speed has been reduced. like it is going to the circulation very slowly. Once when we were discussing about the total duration of action of local anesthetic agents, we had discussed once, for example you are supposed to give 12 injections of local anesthesia in a patient, and you have already crossed your limit, then what to do? While calculating dose, I told you what we can do is after 30 minutes, initial amount of local anesthesia will be reduced to zero. For example, you have given a cartridge 30 minutes before, after 30 minutes, its effect will be nullified. So you can again give another one cartridge which was given 30 minutes before. It means when we will give local anesthesia to any part of for example, you have given local anesthesia, it will not go to the systemic circulation due to vasoconstriction. Once, if epinephrine will not be there, once you will be giving local anesthesia, it will immediately go to the systemic circulation and it will cause systemic toxicity. So actually, vasoconstriction is also limiting the systemic circulation of the local anesthetic agent and reducing the systemic toxicity. The last thing is hemostasis. Again, if there is vasoconstriction, if there is no peripheral vessel is available, in fact they are available but they are vasoconstricted, so again there are chances of less bleeding. The summary is, local anesthetic agents containing epinephrine is causing vasoconstriction of the vessels where injection has been given and ultimately leading to increased depth of anesthesia. They are increasing the duration of anesthesia, because for the more time period of time local anesthetic has been deposited here, it will last longer and it will reduce systemic toxicity, and finally it will cause hemostasis. So these are the indications, or these are the reasons why we are using vasoconstrictors in the local anesthesia. Most commonly used local vasoconstrictor in the local anesthetic agent is epinephrine. Again, it is available in variable dilutions and concentrations. Mostly we are using in 1:100,000 dilution, but in the market local anesthetic agents are available in the dilution of 1:50,000 dilution, 1:100,000 dilution and 1:200,000 dilution. What does it mean? It means, for example, in 1:100,000 dilution means if there are 100,000 parts of local anesthetic agents, it will contain one part of epinephrine. It means its amount in local anesthetic agent is very less, very less. The second most common vasoconstrictor used is levonorgestrel, but again it is not most commonly used. Most commonly used is epinephrine. So these are basically the concentrations, dilutions in which the amount of epinephrine is mentioned. It is very important to know 1:100,000 dilution what actually mean is. It means, for example, 1:1,000 dilution means every ml of local anesthetic agents contains 1 milligram of epinephrine. So if we are using 1:100,000 dilutions, it means 0.0 mg is of epinephrine is available in per ml of local anesthetic agents. When we have calculated the dose, we have already calculated this, the amount of epinephrine available in the one cartridge, because once you will be dealing with the special conditions, for example cardiac patients, or for example those patients in which epinephrine should be given with caution, you have to know about the available epinephrine in the exact amount of epinephrine in that particular cartridge. So it means if we are using 1:100,000 dilutions, it means there is 0.01 milligram of epinephrine in one ml. Our cartridge is of about 1.8 ml. It means each cartridge of 1:100,000 dilution epinephrine contains 0.01 into 1.8 ml. It means 0.01 is available in 1 ml and our cartridge is of 1.8 ml. It means it will be around 0.018 mg per cartridge of epinephrine is available in each cartridge. This is important when we'll be limiting the dose of epinephrine. As I told you regarding in the previous lectures regarding the total amount of epinephrine we can give to a healthy patient is that was 0.2 mg of epinephrine can be given safely to a young healthy 70 kg patient. So when we calculate about the dose of epinephrine, maximum dose of epinephrine, we calculate in the form of 0.01 mg per ml if available, then we have to calculate in that particular amount what will be the total amount or how many cartridges can be given. It can be calculated as we have already discussed, so I'll be not going to the detail about the epinephrine. Coming to the special conditions, like in cardiac patients, we already know the maximum dose is 0.04 mg. It means 0.01 mg is available in 1 ml. It means 0.02 mg is available in 2 cartridges. 0.03 is available in 3 cartridges and so on. So our maximum dose for the cardiac patient is 0.04 mg. So you have to calculate how many cartridges can be given with epinephrine to the cardiac patient. The limitation in cardiac patient is due to, as you know, the epinephrine act, what actually do is when it is causing vasoconstriction in the particular area where it has been injected, at the same time it is also increasing the heart rate. So if a patient is already a heart patient, if his patient, let's suppose if a patient is with cardiac myopathy in which he is already having a low cardiac rate, high cardiac rate, if a patient is, for example, hypertensive, this vasoconstrictor can cause increase in heart rate or the problems can occur. Then epinephrine should be minimized and should be given with precaution in the following patients. Like if a patient is already taking beta blockers, if a patient is on tricyclic antidepressants, if a patient is on halothane or cocaine, or any specific cardiac conditions. Then what you have to do is, for example, if a patient is presented to you with the cardiac myopathy or any cardiac problem and you are supposed to give him epinephrine, then your maximum dose is 0.04 mg. It will be around 2.2 cartridges you can safely give him. After 2.2 cartridges, you can prescribe him with the plain cartridges, the cartridges without epinephrine. The problem with the cartridges without epinephrine, or we can say plain cartridges, is it is less effective, it will last for lesser time, and it will not help in the case of hemostasis. That's why we are always using cartridges with epinephrine. Once you are using epinephrine, certain precautions should be followed. For example, you have to monitor the blood pressure before and after procedure. Then you have to limit the dose of epinephrine to the 0.04 mg. 1:50,000 dilution of epinephrine should be avoided. It means It means it is more concentrated. You have to use diluted forms. For example, you should prefer 1:100,000 dilution or 1:200,000 dilutions. And never use epinephrine impregnated retraction cords. It means don't use excessive epinephrine in any form, in any case. So let's conclude about the vasoconstrictors. Vasoconstrictor most commonly used is epinephrine. We use epinephrine in different dilution forms. The most commonly used is 1:100,000. 1:100,000 means 0.01 mg per ml of epinephrine is available in the local anesthetic agent. The maximum safe dose for any healthy individual is 0.2 mg per visit, and for cardiac patients its maximum dose is 0.04 mg per visit. Okay, and then lastly, what are the functions or what are the indications for epinephrine? These are to reduce the systemic toxicity, to prolong the action duration of local anesthesia, and to achieve hemostasis. So these are certain advantages of using the epinephrine. If you have any question related to vasoconstrictor or related to topical anesthesia, you can post your questions after this lecture. Thank you very much. Stay blessed.